So, a very warm welcome to today's session brought to you by Team Badger's Exam Prep. I hope all of you are doing really well this Sunday morning. Today, we will be looking at a few questions from the June 2020 shift one that had taken place. And I would recommend all of you after the session to just sit back and cover the remaining questions right away. By this particular default, you'll be able to at least cover 100 set of questions. You'd be able to cover one entire paper and 100 concepts altogether. You would have actually revised. Good morning, everybody. Good morning, Rupesh, Surbhi, Kriti, Tehmina, Satya, Reena, Chandni. There's Shalini also who has who's joined us, Rizwana. Good morning, everybody. Dulal, Zamar, Asha. Good morning, everyone. Good morning, Zia. Zia's like really adorable and she's been like, you know, flattering me the last entire week. I don't know for what reason. Okay. All right. So without further ado, I think let's just very quickly get started with today's session. Please feel free to connect with us on the Telegram platform. We will be sharing a couple of details. I'll also start sharing the PDFs of the week, especially for all the people appearing for the December attempt. I will start sharing PDFs of the week. We'll also try to conduct these review sessions of those PDFs that I'll be sharing. So a couple of important things that we are coming up with just stay tuned on the Telegram platform. Like I said, today we will be looking at June 2020 shift one. This is the first shift that we'll be looking at. Please feel free right after this only to cover the entire shift. We'll cover a few sample questions and next time also we'll continue with some very important basic questions that are there. By and large, you'll be able to see that, you know, moderate to okayish difficult was the level of this particular paper, right? It wasn't very difficult. Good morning everyone. So without further ado, I think let's just very quickly dive into, let's just very quickly get started. I'm so sorry. Right. Let's just very quickly get started. Like I've been saying, please make it happen. These are the quotes for the week. I'll share more, but please make it happen and don't worry at all. And as much as possible, I think eat healthy. That is a major recommendation. If you all need any support to prepare for the December edition of the NET exam, or you need any help in any of the SET exam, or for instance, please do give assistant professor exams. Like Haryana, there are so many states. Haryana, Punjab, they also conduct these assistant professor exams. The notifications, as and when they'll come out, we'll let you know about those notifications. But do sit for these exams. They'll be very helpful, very beneficial for all of you. And if you need any support, we are going to be kickstarting the foundation batches for the December attempt also. Any PhD support, any literature-based exam that you're preparing for. Now there is like a complete overhaul that we've done. There's also the production of async videos that's going on in full swing for paper 2 NET English. So please feel free to connect for entire coverage. These are some of the highlights that we'll be doing in a structured manner with async recording. So there is synchronic study and there's live study and there's async study. Async study is that which you can do it at your own pace. So really good quality, high quality video lectures are being recorded for all of you, which will really help you to cover some of the basics. And of course, there's live support being given to all of you. So in case if you're interested, please feel free to take a look at that as well. All right, coming on to the June 2020 first attempt, which one of the following journals publishes articles related to critical theory exclusively? We've done this question multiple times. It's exclusively related to critical theory. What is the right answer? You also use elimination methods. Salma Gundi, associated with? Who was the person associated with Salma Gundi? Remember, Washington Irving is associated with Salma Gundi. So you can also use elimination method and keep eliminating your answer choices as well. That is also one of the best strategies to actually answer correctly for these exams altogether. So what is the right answer, everybody? What's the right answer? Let's just quickly see how many of you are able to get the right answer here. Fantastic. I think a bunch of you have already started answering the questions. Yes, absolutely right. Absolutely right. Yes. What is the right answer, everybody? forgot. Why is my pen not working here? Right, it's working. What is the right answer? Yes, diacritics is absolutely the right answer. Diacritics is absolutely the right answer. It was published in 1971 at the Cornell University. You should also know the epicenter, diacritics 1971 at the Cornell University, because if in case you're getting questions related to this, you should be able to answer it. You know, it was published by John Hopkins University Press, John Hopkins University Press at the Cornell University. And we are able to see that, you know, the quarterly, it is a quarterly journal. Remember when we are looking at Salma Gundi, that's also a quarterly journal. Kalalo is publishing poetry, fiction, criticism, interviews also Kalalo does that. And Grand Street is also more than critical theory. Grand Street also tries to publish works which are more than critical theory. Now, the next two questions in the paper are really simple questions. They are related to structuralism and post-structuralism. Okay, look at this. Which one of the following is correct about Saussure's analysis of language? So this is related to structuralism. I think we've discussed it so many times, so this should not go wrong with anybody whatsoever. Which of the following is correct about Saussure's analysis of language? What is the right answer here, everybody? Yes, absolutely. Please do that. Please do that. I'll better put my comments here. Easier for me to view that. Okay, yes, absolutely right. Absolutely right. So Lang is basically, so remember Chomsky, the same paper also asks you the same question about performance and competence. So remember when we are talking about parole is actually, so when we are talking about your competence and performance, parole is your performance, Chomsky's performance. Remember performance and competence, whereas Lang that we are talking about, that is the system of language, is actually the competence which is coming in. So competence and performance are terms given by Noam Chomsky, and parole and Lang are terms that Saussure is helping us understand. Lang is the system of language which is actually finite, and parole is the infinite structure that we are able to see. Remember, these are the features of structuralism. And the same paper gave you questions related to post-structuralism as well. Which is the best position of post-structuralist criticism? So every day, if you're also practicing one theory, if you're revising one theory, you're reading it from multiple sources, catering to it, reviewing the content altogether of one theory, that will be something which will be very, very helpful for all of you to keep in mind. Okay, what is the right answer here? What becomes the right answer here? Read it properly, and then I'm sure you'll be able to answer it correctly. So if in case you're looking at this particular question, what becomes the correct answer? So post-structuralist criticism, what is it focusing on? What is it focusing on? Yes, 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 absolutely right. Come on now to the next question. Yes, Shalini, parole is a manifestation of the Lang. Very good. Excellent. Very good. I'm so glad all of you are revising everything. And Shalini is really a sweetheart. Yes. So please remember that post-structuralism focused on multiplicity. It was denying absolute nature of things. There is a complete denial of absolute nature of things. So what are we doing? There is a denial of absolute nature. And what are we focusing on? We are focusing on multiplicity. We are focusing on what? We are focusing on multiplicity altogether. So that is something that you have to keep in mind. Now, when we are focusing on multiplicity, please keep that in mind, that which of the following assumptions is best expressing definite structures? These are words that you don't like in post-structuralism. Language is representational. Apprehension of reality is a construct. Apprehension of reality is a construct. Knowledge operates according to procedures that are axiomatic. No. So basically, C is the most appropriate assumption. C is the most appropriate assumption. Why? Because there is an apprehension of reality which becomes a construct in the post-structuralist world. So you are denying absolute nature of things. You're denying the absolute nature of things altogether. That is something that you're absolutely against. So C is absolutely the right answer. So can you just see that in the same paper, they have given you questions related to two theories that are interconnected. So that is something which is coming in. Criticism, next question. Which one of the following statements is true about Aristotle's Poetics? So, which is actually true when we are looking at Aristotle's Poetics. So, which one do you think is going to be true whenever we are probably discussing about Aristotle's Poetics altogether? Sorry. Yes, everyone. True. The question says true. Yes, Tamina, Muhammad Ashraf, Satya, everybody has given the right answer. Ashraf, I saw your IG message. The classes have been conducted, by the way. So every day we're having sessions. Okay, I saw your message that where were you? There have not been any classes, ma'am. No, all the classes were there. So maybe you're not using the application judiciously. All the sessions for the foundation batches, the score booster batches, they were regularly being conducted. So you may want to probably see the application also once to figure out, you know, when all the sessions are taking place. But the sessions were taking place all throughout. Okay, so here Aristotle is defining tragedy and comedy in terms of mimesis and poetics, right? Plato, of course, dismissed art as far removed from reality because it's an imitation of an idea. Aristotle is defining tragedy and comedy as mimesis of actions of men, as mimesis of actions of men. So that is what you're able to basically see. He asserts the value of poetry by integrating rhetoric and imitation. He asserts the value of poetry by focusing on both rhetoric and imitation. He asserted the value of poetry by giving preference to rhetoric over imitation. He asserted the value of poetry by focusing on imitation. Yes, he was focusing on imitation. He says that comedy and tragedy, what are they? They are mimesis of actions of men. They are mimesis of actions of men. Mimesis of actions of men. The best resource to study literary criticism is, of course, the original text, or you can also study it simultaneously with non-fictional prose writings, or you can take Habib's. Habib's is really good when it comes to literary criticism. Rather, there is an information overload. So especially if you're preparing for the December attempt, I highly, highly recommend you to definitely do literary criticism via Habib's itself. Okay, that's like a really good book. In the Anxiety of Influence, which of the following definitions is given by Harold Bloom to explain the term Kleinemann? So Anxiety of Influence, Harold Bloom is using which term to actually give what is the definition that he has given to explain Kleinemann? So remember, Anxiety of Influence, what is he talking about? How can we shun away from the overarching burden that we are having of the people from the past altogether? So that is what we are looking at. 1973, Harold Bloom's Anxiety of Influence is coming in. Excellent, we've started getting the right answers. So Kleinemann is the poetic misreading or misprision proper. Basically what he was saying is, he was talking about six revisionary approaches. So how is the poet breaking away from the anxiety of influence? That means the anxiety of the predecessors altogether. So he talks about the fact that, you know, there are six revisionary approaches. And that is when he's coming on to poetic misreading or mispression proper. So what is it that he's talking about? He's talking about poetic mispression. So the six ways through which a poet can completely shun away, move out of the influence of the ancestors altogether. So Kleinemann is basically what we are talking about, poetic misreading or mispression proper. So please remember that. Anxiety of Influence is also a very important work. Chris Baldick, if you're reading every day, 5 to 10 pages right now, I think most of these concepts will be covered. Or you can also read the Penguin edition. Penguin edition gets a little intimidating right now if you're preparing for the June edition. But if you're aspirants of the later editions, then I would recommend you to also take a look at Penguin edition altogether. Okay, the term popularized by which critic? Localization, global and local, portmanteau, globalization, localization. Remember, globalization, localization. It's a portmanteau that we are able to see of globalization. So globalization is coming in. And localization, right? Localization, globalization, and localization. So it's a portmanteau. You're joining these two words together. You're joining these two words together, and it's coined by the sociologist. Yes, Ronald Robertson in Harvard Business Review. Harvard Business Review, 1980. Harvard Business Review, 1980. And that's the reason Harvard Business Review is always considered to be very cutting edge. So in 1980, what we are able to see is that Harvard Business Review is trying to talk about how you are having global and local come together. The universalizing tendencies are clearly there. You are able to see that, you know, there are universal tendencies and particular tendencies also. So global and local coming together, that's Ronald Robertson. He is coining the term in the Harvard Business Review in 1980s altogether. Okay, who among the following presented the concept of multi-accentuality of the sign, saying that signs possess an inner dialectical quality and an evaluative accent, and an evaluative accent, multi-accentuality of the sign. What is the right answer here? What is the right answer, everybody? Please answer it quickly and let us know what is the right answer. You can also keep a copy of this paper next time. So we'll be practicing a lot of these papers. You can keep copies of them. Yes. Valentin Voloshinov is absolutely the right answer. He's giving the concept of multi-accentuality of sign. What is multi-accentuality of sign? You know, you can actually compare it with the class struggle. What was he saying? He said that ruling classes wanted uni-accentual signs. They wanted, what did they wanted? They wanted uni-accentual signs. I'll give you this example because all of you are postmodern students. Take the example of your so-called restaurants that we are having. So there's this restaurant called Social. Okay. Now, for instance, over here, whenever we go, my mother becomes really uncomfortable. Why? Because, you know, it's actually designed in a particular way where it's trying to imitate that of a prison house. So the plates are now, of course, the newer socials that are coming in, like the Worli Social in Bombay, or you know, the socials here also, like in DLS Saket, etc., they've got like a different look and feel altogether. But when we are talking about Social per se, it is imitating a prison house. So it's very uncomfortable for somebody to, you know, go to a fine dine and see those kind of plates altogether. So everybody wanted uni-accentual notions, right? If you're going to a restaurant, if you're going to a fine dine, there should be proper cutlery being presented to you. They're very uncomfortable. So mostly people wanted uni-accentual signs altogether. But what you're able to see when we are looking at Valentin Voloshinov is saying, no, we need multi-accentual. Signs have to be having multiple values altogether. Signs need to have multiple ways of representation altogether. So that was really important for Marxist perspective also. Ruling classes wanted uni-accentual signs, but resistance made those signs multi-accentual. Multi-accentual. The signs were not just, so for instance, eating and going out for food was just not like, you know, a fine dine look and feel that you will get, or for that matter, studying doesn't just mean that you're studying engineering, doctoral degrees, but there are these cutting edge other curriculums that are coming in, like Web3 or you know, your so-called blockchain, crypto, etc. So multi-accentuality of the sign becomes really important for all of us to understand, and that is a concept that Voloshinov is giving us. Okay, you can make a parallel between the class struggle and how this metaphor is being used over there. Which British administrator sought to make everything as English as possible in the country, which resembles England in nothing, as recorded by Sir Thomas Munro? So who wanted to make everything as English as possible? So there was a like crazy derogation that was coming in, but who was the one that we're looking at over here? Who was the person who wanted to do that? He was appointed in 1786 as the Commander-in-Chief of British India and the Governor of the Presidency of Fort William. So 1786 is when he's coming. So whom are we talking about? Who's this person that we are talking about over here? Absolutely right. This is Lord Cornwallis. I see some of you writing Lord Hastings. It's Lord Cornwallis. It's Lord Cornwallis that we are talking about over here. Lord Cornwallis wanted to actually just make sure that everything was colored, plastered, you know, it was plastered in English tunes altogether in a country that was having nothing resembling England at all. Be the climate, the people, the preferences, etc. Nothing, none of those practices were actually English in nature. Okay, which according to Thomas Hobbes is the only science God has bestowed on mankind that informs the structure of his monumental book, Leviathan. So it's really fun. So you can actually, when you're writing these PhD answers and when you're talking about modernist movements like Cubism, which are using a lot of these shapes, you need to mention these sort of cases also to provide the richness of your answers, to show the examiner that you're a very well-read person altogether. What is the right answer? Geometry is absolutely right. Geometry is absolutely right. So when we are all students of modernism and when we are looking at Cubism, Fauvism, vorticism for that matter, or when we are looking at Cubism in particular, where images are coming in the shapes format. So what are you able to see? You're able to see that modernist movements are also experimenting with these geometrical shapes. Or look at J.M. Hopkins' Curtal Sonnet. It's 3/4 of a Petrarchan sonnet. That means it's a mathematical sonnet form. Or C.P. Snow, Two Cultures, telling you about the importance of integrating science and humanities all together. So please remember, quote these examples while you're writing your entrances also. That mathematical references have always been there. New criticism is a scientific approach altogether, right? Geometry. So Hobbes thought only geometry as the science because, you know, he was able to see practical use over here. And he says that, you know, it'll actually allow humans to understand the cause of a phenomena. You can understand the cause of a phenomena. That is what he talks about. Okay, so please remember that. So geometry is a science according to Thomas Hobbes. It's a science according to Thomas Hobbes. He considered geometry to be a sort of a science altogether. So please keep that aspect also in detail, in mind altogether. Okay, as mentioned, my first acquaintance with poets, which poet does Hazlitt describe as only person I ever knew who answered the idea of a man of genius? So this is a surprising friend of his that he's talking about. Okay, he's mentioning him. My first acquaintance with poet is an important work by Hazlitt. And remember, this article is getting published in 1823 in the Liberal. The Liberal is where we are able to see that this is getting published. What is the right answer? Coleridge is right. Coleridge is right. Yeah, Indra, Bache, we will cover most of the questions, so don't worry. We will cover at least like papers and the samples all together. Today, we'll cover a few questions from June 2022, Shift 1. And in the next class onwards, we'll try to cover a majority of questions. Okay, right now, for instance, I've just taken some sample questions. So the first few questions which were there in one of the papers that we'd received. So yes, we will be doing. So I'll share the roster with all of you as well. Don't worry, we'll practice and you can keep these videos also with you. So Coleridge is absolutely the right answer. My first acquaintance with poet, Coleridge becomes the correct answer. Only person I ever knew who answered the idea of man as a genius. Which one of the following essays holds that as a method, realism is a complete failure? Use the elimination method. Even if you don't know My Confession by McCarthy, Why Novels Matter, The Decay of Lying, which among the following is actually a critic who's against, you know, realistic approaches, is starting the art for art's sake movement? So here you don't know all the answers, but does that mean you cannot get a 99.99 percentile or a percentile really competitive in paper 2? You of course can get it. You of course can get it because of the fact that you have to intelligently answer some questions. What is the right answer? Pleasure, bachche, pleasure. What is the right answer here, everybody? The Decay of Lying is the right answer. Oscar Wilde is absolutely right. Oscar Wilde is absolutely right. The Decay of Lying is the right answer. So for most of the questions, don't be in a hurry. Use the elimination method as well. He says that realism is a complete failure. 1891. These are essays which were a part of his collection altogether that were coming in. 1891. All these essays are coming in. Realism as a method is a complete failure. And in the preface to the picture of Dorian Gray, what does he say? He says, no work of art is good or bad. It's either well written or badly written. And his friend Walter Pater is doing analysis of Renaissance as well. And so whenever we talk about the Yellow Paper, for instance, or when we are looking at how, they both Walter Pater, Oscar Wilde, the Symbolist Manifesto, the Pre-Raphaelite Brotherhood, all of these movements together in the 19th century are precursors to new criticism as well. They are precursors to Russian formalism, new criticism as well. Which of the following novels is structured into a poem of 999 lines preceded by a foreword, followed by a commentary and an index? So there is a foreword. This is the structure of the work that you are having. There is a foreword. Then there are 999 lines of poetry that is coming in. After that, you are having a commentary and an index. So which work are we talking about? Which work are we talking about? Vladimir Nabokov. What is the right answer here, everybody? Yes, absolutely right. Absolutely right. Absolutely right. Pale Fire is right. Vladimir Nabokov, 1926. So this is the work that we are able to see. Nabokov's writing. Nabokov known for Lolita. So you can include this in your American Russian writings notes as well. Pale Fire is a work which is coming in. It's a postmodern work also in a particular way, despite the fact that it's coming in 1926. But the kind of writing which is there, it is almost, there's a question in this particular paper, the questionnaire. We'll just talk about that also. So a lot of 20th century writings coming in. Which among the following novels includes a questionnaire for the readers? Do you like the story so far? Do you like the story so far? The same paper, by the way, has a question on reader response theory as well. So you're able to see that they're taking those questions really seriously. What is the right answer? The postmodern novel coming in 1967. This is a postmodern. Satyajit has answered it correctly. Snow White. Snow White by Donald Barthelme. Absolutely right. So this is a 1967 postmodern writing. Ina, if you're there, Ina was asking how can we prepare. So these are certain concepts that you have to know. Metafictional work in postmodern writings. Roman effluve, Roman thesis. So many political social novels are also coming in. So the various diversified languages, post-war literature for that matter. So you need to know about works like Slaughterhouse-Five or your Black African writings also that are coming in, Afro-American writings that are coming in. So postmodernism is like a hugely variegated concept altogether. You'll have to cover a lot of them. So Snow White by Donald Barthelme. What is the subject of Ivan's controversial essay in Brothers Karamazov? Yesterday also, we were talking about Russian writings. We had about 2 to 3 questions. So integrate yesterday's lecture with today's lecture as well. Ivan's controversial essays in Brothers Karamazov by Fyodor Dostoevsky. Yes, Kuhu, French Lieutenant Women is also important. Absolutely right. 100 Years of Solitude. Very good. Shalini is a Roman effluve. Very good. Very good. Yes. Yes. Ecclesiastical Courts, Neha Bakar, Dulal. Everybody is answering it correctly. So Ivan's controversial essay in Brothers Karamazov by Fyodor Dostoevsky is actually a deliberation on ecclesiastical courts. The novel was serialized in January 1879 to 1880, right? 1879 to 1880, we were able to see Jan to November. This was getting serialized. This novel was getting serialized. It was coming in the form of a series altogether in the Russian Messenger. Where was it coming in? It was coming in the Russian Messenger. These questions also come in. So you can keep it in mind. It's coming in serialized edition in the Russian Messenger. And we are able to see that Ivan is writing this controversial essay on ecclesiastical courts, deliberating ecclesiastical courts altogether. Which one of the following Sherlock Holmes stories refers to a significant event in English history? You can add it to your Restoration Age notes as well. You can add this particular question to your Restoration Age notes as well. What is the right answer here, everybody? What becomes the right answer largely over here? whom are we talking about? Arthur Conan Doyle's work, which is referring to the English Civil War. It is referring to the English Civil War, 1642 all the way till 51 also, which continues. Yes, the Musgrove Ritual is the right answer. So Musgrove Ritual, so what was happening is that the English Civil War, crowning of King Charles the Second, we were able to see that for the very first time, the English people were revolting against the monarchic system altogether, which was unthinkable at all for many, many people. So what we are able to see over here is that that entire 17th century, your Carolin period, your Puritan interregnum, then the coming of Charles II, these are pivotal aspects that are being presented over here. So the Musgrove Ritual is actually dealing with these historical events. The Musgrove Ritual is dealing with these historical events altogether. Right, the Civil War, the crowning of Charles II, that is being dealt with over here in this particular work. So basically, key moments of the 17th century history are coming in the Musgrove Ritual altogether. So that is another thing. The next question from Gothic literature, who is the author of a fragment, one of the earliest example of vampire stories? Gothic literature, 19th century novels, these are some categories, postmodern novels, these are certain important categories from where you do get questions. A fragment is a early vampire story. Remember, there was a competition that was being conducted, and during that competition, this work was coming in. So a fragment is an unfinished vampire story by... Who's writing this? Yes, Neha Bhakat has answered it. Lord Byron. Lord Byron. It was written as a part of a famous Gothic story context. Mary Shelley, P.B. Sherry, Claire Claremont. They were participating in it, right? So there was basically this contest that was coming in where we were able to see in 1816 where Claire Claremont, P.B. Shelley, Mary Shelley, Byron, Claire Claremont, P.B. Shelley, Mary Shelley, as well as Lord Byron. They were all a part. Claire Claremont, Percy Bysshe Shelley, Mary Shelley, Lord Byron. They were all a part of this competition. And a fragment is it's an unfinished vampire story. It is an unfinished vampire story. Right? That is something that you can keep in mind. Which of the following poems by Philip Larkin deals with the trauma of a rape victim who says, "Even so distant, I can taste the grief. Even so distant, I can taste the grief." What is the right answer here? "Even so distant, I can taste the grief." What is the right answer, everybody here? What becomes the right answer here, everyone? So all the poets, Larkin is dealing with the trauma of the rape victim. "Even so distant, I can taste the grief." Larkin, 1922-85, very important. Remember, he goes by the pseudonym Brunette Coleman. He is going by the pseudonym Brunette Coleman. Brunette Coleman. Brunette Coleman. This question can also come. He goes by the pseudonym Brunette Coleman. Deceptions is absolutely the right answer. Deceptions is the right answer. Telling you the trauma of a rape victim. Beautiful lines. Very painful, very touching lines altogether that are coming in. Okay, moving on to Irish poetry. In which of the following bog poems does Seamus Heaney speak about the perishable treasure of a body murdered, forgotten, nameless, terrible? Compare this to Deserted Village also, because Deserted Village is also telling you about sweet Auburn, people living in Auburn, and what kind of plight they have to undergo, dying nameless deaths altogether. What is the right answer here, everybody? Sorry. Yes, Strange Fruit is the right answer. Strange Fruit is absolutely the right answer here, everyone. That is the correct answer. So Strange Fruit is there. Bog poems, there are various important aspects that are coming in. Seamus Heaney is the Irish poet of great measure and great value altogether. And Strange Fruit is coming, which is telling you about, so you can compare it with, you know, how the bog poems are representing the forgotten people altogether, because obviously remember the bogs are basically where all your skulls, all your dead bodies can be excavated as well, and that marshy part is also something that bog poems are talking about, and Strange Fruit is coming in over there. telling you about the murdered, forgotten. Look at these words, forgotten, nameless, and compare it with the deserted village as well. Who among the following wrote Mazeppa, a long narrative poem about a 17th century military leader? So imagine two questions coming on the same writer. This also happens in your exams. What is the right answer? 17th century military leader of Ukraine, getting published in 1819. Yesterday also, we had done a lot of questions of Byron. No. Literary works, just check. Neha's giving the answer first. Neha's answers mostly are coming first. Just check it. I don't know her personally, and how will it impact? I'm not creating the NTA paper as well, right? So imagine what benefit will it do. Yes, Byron is the right answer. Byron is the right answer. Byron is absolutely the right answer here. Lord Byron is the person writing Mazeppa. I think in between yesterday and today, from the YouTube lecture, also yesterday, a few questions that we were practicing during the mocknet at 10:30 p.m. In the Score Booster batch classes, or otherwise also, I think in the past 2 to 3 days, we've done a lot of practice on Byron via questions only. So even if you've compiled it and put it together in a particular area, you would be able to review Byron faster for your exam. Which one of the following statements is appropriately true about Harold Pinter's plays? About Harold Pinter's plays. Which is true? Which is true about Harold Pinter's plays? Which is true? Harold Pinter, 1930 to 2008, Nobel Prize winning writer. We're able to see he's using black humor, black comedy, comedy of menace, right? That is something which is being used. Other playwrights, David Campton, Nigel Dennis, N.F. Simpson, they're all associated with that, right? You can even make a note of it. David Campin, right? So all of them are a part of this. All of them are a part of this. David Campton. Campton is there. David Campton. Yes, C is the right answer. C is the right answer. Nigel Dennis, all of these. So you can, they are also a part. Nigel Dennis, Simpson, all of them are actually a part altogether that you're able to see. N.F. Simpson. So N.F. Simpson, Nigel Dennis, David Campton. So what we are able to see over here is menace is in the air, but it's not pinned down and explained. It's in the air, we are able to see that, but it's not pinned down altogether. That is something that is not happening at all. Yesterday, I think we did a question on Kafka as well. So Kafka is one of the first precursors to the absurd movement. The absurd movement becomes a precursor to the comedy of menace. Comedy of menace is associated predominantly with people like Harold Pinter, and other such similar writers, David Campton, Nigel Dennis, N.S. Simpson are also coming in. What game do characters play in Act 2 of Harold Pinter's The Birthday Party? What game are they playing? What game are they playing? What game are they playing? Which is the game that is being played by them? What game are they playing? So again, can you just see the same question coming? So Byron, 2 questions, Harold Pinter, 2 questions. So you yourself will be able to analyze. Now, what happens other times when you're listening to analysis, only one question comes from one particular writer. That's all crazy, in your exam. So there are so many times where I've seen 3 questions coming on Milton. So there is no there's no dearth of, one writer being covered twice. This is an example. This is a live example in front of you. Right, in June 2020 shift 1, you're able to see that there are 2 questions on Byron, there are 2 questions which are mentioning Harold Pinter, there are 2 questions mentioning Coleridge as well. So understand these patterns as well. Understand these patterns and thoroughly do whatever you're doing. That is something which is very critically important. What is the right answer here? Yes, C is the right answer. The characters play blind man's bluff, basically. So bluff, that is what they're playing in Act 2. Birthday Party, 1957. It is classified as comedy of menace. It is set in the middle of a small birthday party that absolutely goes wrong because 2 strangers are coming in. Right, homecoming, betrayal, other plays of Harold Pinter are equally important. Yesterday, I think we also did a question related to Tom Stoppard's writing. So all of these are important postmodern writers and thinkers. So Blind Man's Buff is the right answer. That is the game that they are playing. The Duchess of Malfi is based on the Duchess of Malfi, again, a very important Jacobean tragedy that is coming in Webster or Ben Jonson. You definitely do get questions coming on there. It is based on a particular work over here, right, which is based on true historical events that had taken place between Duchess Givona di Aragona. Givona di Aragona was murdered. Givona di Aragona. So there was the Duchess. You had the Duchess, right? So Duchess Givona di Aragona was actually murdered by her brothers. Aragona was murdered by her brothers. Yes, Italian novella. Italian novella was based on the lives of this. So Duchess of Malfi is based on the Italian novella. This Italian novella is based on the real story. It is based on the real story of Duchess of Givona di Aragona, who was murdered by her brothers because she married secretly. Right. And this is, of course, a Senecan revenge tragedy, also called a Jacobian age revenge tragedy. White Devil, Duchess of Malfi. You need to be having these notes on your fingertips. Now, see, again, the next question, structuralism, post-structuralism questions came in. Two questions. There's another question on structuralist theory. There's another question on structuralist theory. So why have I picked up some of these questions? To prove to you that there is not anything, there is no particular question that only one topic is being asked. So there'll be one question from that particular topic. Sometimes from restoration, please, you can get 2 to 3 questions. Sometimes from the same writer, you can get 2 questions, as you are able to see. Okay, so please keep the idea for this is that you should know that whatever you're doing, cover it exhaustively. That is something which is important. What is the right answer here, everybody? What becomes the right answer, folks? Please tell us. What is the right answer here? What is the right answer here? Yes, some of you are answering it correctly. So Shalini, Literary Worms, Juhi, Nicomoni, everybody has answered it correctly. Yes, perfect. Structuralist theory is not limiting itself only to verbal codes. Remember that. That is not what structuralist theory. Everything is within the text, that is true. But it is also dealing with written codes also. It is not only dealing with verbal codes, it's also dealing with written codes also. It is starting as a work of of Saussure and not Derrida, by the way. Right, Derrida is associated with post-structuralism altogether. So if we take it one by one, structuralism is concerned with signs and signification. This is true. And therefore, you are able to see A is there everywhere. This is true also. B, structuralist theory considers only verbal conventions. No, it is considering written codes also. So wherever there is B, that will be eliminated. That B part will be eliminated altogether. Right, structuralism began in the works of Jacques Derrida. That is not true. Derrida is not there. Derrida is not the starting point. Saussure is the starting point. Derrida is associated with post-structuralism per se. Right, so wherever there is C is not there. So wherever there is C is here. So this will be eliminated. So B is the right answer. Structuralism challenges the long-standing belief that literature reflects a given reality. Yes, all signs are arbitrary, but without them, we cannot comprehend reality. That is also true. Right? So all of them, ADE, they are right. ADE, they are right. So even if these questions, you just look at the answer choice and solve the questions, you will be able to answer it correctly. Right? So that is something that we are able to see is coming to be true. Which two terms among the following are associated with formalist criticism? They are associated with formalist criticism. Which two terms are associated with formalist criticism? What is the right answer here? Formalist criticism. So formalism, if you go back to your notes, you can refer to them. You will be able to understand that. What is the right answer? Is aura associated? There's a collapse of aura because of capitalism. That's what Walter Benjamin talks about. So use elimination method also. You can use, yes, very good. You can use elimination method also. So when you are able to use the elimination method, you will be able to see that these are not appropriate. Defamiliarization and foregrounding. Defamiliarization and foregrounding are the terms that are coming in. Formalism, Roman Jakobson, Viktor Slavonsky, they are associated with formalism. You are able to see that foregrounding of the text and backgrounding of the context is something that is taking place. Whereas new historicism will upturn this. They will foreground the background. But here there is foregrounding of the text that is taking place altogether. We are able to see that there is a certain degree of foregrounding of the text that is taking place, right? So that is another important aspect that we're able to look at. Right, and actant are, you know, your structural symbols altogether that are coming in, the binary opposition pairing that is taking place altogether. But here what you are able to see that foregrounding and formalism are associated with formalist criticism. Who among the following believe that rhyme is not an integral part of poetry? Rhyme is not an integral part. If you don't have rhyming words, it doesn't mean that, oh my god, it's not going to be a poem. So who said that rhyme is not an integral part of poetry? Yes, Manju, that's right. What is the right answer here, everybody? Manju is also studying really well. Yes, Horace and Sidney is the right answer. Ars Poetica and Apology for Poesy. We are able to see they're both treatises on art. Horace as well as Sidney say that rhyme is not integral part of poetry. It's not important that, you know, I create a rhyming phrase, then only my work is poetic. Rhyme is not at all important. Rhyme is not something that we really need to be mindful of when we are talking about poetic creation. So that is the right answer. Very good. Very good. That is true. Who among the following are the two greatest masters of French language that T.S. Eliot contrasts with Dryden and Milton in Metaphysical Poets? That he is contrasting with Dryden and Milton in Metaphysical Poets. Whom are we talking about over here? So T.S. Eliot is contrasting, there are these two people, with Dryden and Milton in Metaphysical Poets, coming in 1921. He talks about, the changes in English poetry after the Metaphysical Poets had come in, how they changed the English poetry altogether. Yes, absolutely right. Absolutely right. C is the right answer. That is true. So Jean Racine and Charles Baudelaire, you're able to see that they are being compared. Jean Racine and Charles Baudelaire. So Racine and Baudelaire are being compared. Right, Racine and Baudelaire are being compared altogether in this essay on Metaphysical Poetry. T.S. Eliot's essays are important modern non-fictional prose writings works that you have to do it in greater detail. Okay, let's stop over here. Let's just do this one question and let's pause over here. It's like a really simple question, by the way. Right, this is like a really, really simple question, by the way. So I hope that all of you will be able to answer this question correctly. Let's see how many of you are able to get the right answer. Yes. Fantastic. This was like a really simple question, right? This was like a very, very simple question. And that's the reason I hope that all of you were able to answer it. So Bacon and Montague, they are considered to be the pioneering writers who are helping us understand it better, right? So Bacon is coming in. So please keep that in mind. What is this? Sorry. Right, so that is of course there. So we're in a position to see Francis Bacon and Montague. They are popularizing the genre. Francis. So when we are looking at Rabelais is a different work altogether, and Burton's Anatomy of Melancholy is also different. But it's not popularizing the so-called tradition of writing periodical essay. The tradition of writing periodical essay is something which is getting popularized by Bacon and Montague only. Right, Bacon and Montague only. So that is what we are able to see over here. Now what I'll do is right now only just sit back, don't leave, cover all the other questions that are there in this June 2020 shift one paper. I'm just telling you the schedule. Also we'll cover a few more papers in the coming time, so that it really helps you out altogether. I'm just opening the schedule up. Next time what we'll do is we'll try to cover all the questions in that paper. Today I think I've taken sample papers, but I think we can, it'll just take 1.5 hours or 2 hours at max. We'll be able to cover most of them. I will also give an announcement on the Telegram platform. Next session also, we'll do an analysis of the paper. Before the paper, I will let you know what analysis are we doing, so that if in case you want to be prepared, you can actually prepare that and come as well. Don't worry, before you write your exams, we'll cover all the attempts. We'll cover the June 2020 shift one, shift two. We'll cover December 2022. June 2021 that was merged together will do that as well properly. So you don't have to worry about it. Simran, please don't feel depressed at all, right? Please be happy. I'm sure things are going to be fine. They will work out. They will be really, you'll find your way altogether. So there's no need for you to be depressed at all, right? There's absolutely no need for you to be depressed. Everyone, please cheer up yourselves. Take a break if you want to. Then start studying. Just complete this paper only. I would recommend that. I would recommend you to complete the paper and then probably get up, okay? Thanks a ton, everyone. Yes, Kuhu, don't. That's right, Simran, please be fine. Don't worry at all. Thanks everyone for joining. We really appreciate that. I really, really appreciate everybody joining us on a Sunday morning. Complete the paper right away. And like I said, in the upcoming days, we will practice a few more papers that will really help you to set the tone altogether. Thank you so much, everyone. God bless you. I will give you a lot of support on the Telegram platform as well. So please stay tuned over there. And also the app session. I don't know what all changes they keep on taking place. So app session will be on Wednesday at 8 p.m. App session will be on Wednesday at 8 p.m. So please block your calendars for the application session. It will be on Wednesday at 8 p.m. Or okay, what we can do is on Wednesday at 8 p.m. when I meet you, let's cover the remaining questions that are there from June 2020 shift one. So whatever remaining questions will be there, which are very important, we will cover those in for the Wednesday session. So this is the application session that is there. So please do attend, block your calendars as well. All right. Thanks everyone for joining. I really appreciate that. God bless each one of you. Take good care of yourself. Study hard, study well. Be very organized. Take good care. Thanks everyone. Thanks. Khuda hafiz, Shazia. Take care, Nikumoni, Madhusmita, Suman, Seema, Reena. Thank you so much, Reena. That's so sweet of you, Bache. That's so sweet of you. And Simran, please cheer up. We're all like, you know, so there are almost a bunch of 100 people now. Of course, people are leaving who are there with you. So please be happy. You have a lot of love from all of us. So there is no need for you to be sad, because I think love is also like a really rare commodity these days. It's not even a commodity. So you're having a lot of love and blessings from our end. Good positive energies from our end. Please be happy. Keep yourselves happy. Thank you so much. Take good care of yourselves. God bless. Bye. Yes, absolutely. Easy. Yeah. July mein ho, August mein ho, everything is fine. Right. God bless. Bye, everyone. Take care. God bless. Enjoy your Sunday.